We've got a great panel for you guys today on the Young Turks. I've got three wonderful women activists. Rosario Dawson, actress, activist, and a person who's introducing Bernie Sanders throughout the country. Okay. Now, I'd list all the movies, but we run out of time. But you are currently in Daredevil and Jessica Jones in Netflix, and then Luke Cage is coming out?
In September.
September. Okay. All right. I've seen almost all your movies. Linda Sarsour is co-founder of Muslim Democratic Club of New York, and she's from Brooklyn. I know that partly because you won an award, and I love this, the Do-Gooder Award from the Brooklyn Community Foundation. So you're one of those do-gooders that Bill O'Reilly warned me about.
Pretty much.
Yeah. And you're also you also won American Muslim of the Year. See, we have something in common. Okay?
Yeah.
I won Golden Turk. How's that for a funny name of an award?
That's pretty good. I like it.
So we'll talk a little bit more about all of your activism in a second as well, of course. And then Nomiki Konst?
Konst, like Konst. Constitution.
Okay, like Constitution,
right. Right.
And you worked on Barack Obama's election as Gen 44. Mm-hmm. Co-founder, was it?
National co-chair.
National co-chair.
A few of us.
Okay. And a current Democratic strategist. Okay.
Yeah, more or less.
and you've got a lot in your history that's similar to mine as well. I never, you won a change award, right? Weren't you like the greatest changer of all time?
Something like that. And, you know, I won in high school, talks most, says least. There's a bunch of, you know, they just give them out after a while.
No, I got it.
It's the same people who just rotate.
No, it was a really badass sounding title. Champion of Change.
Yeah, I got one of those too.
Okay. All right, okay.
Well, I got the President's Volunteer Award in 2011.
That's pretty
the senior. Yeah. Champion of Change.
Now, we can all agree that this pales in comparison to Golden Turk Award, but
yes,
okay,
yes.
All right, not bad. So pretty great panel over here. So first question for you guys. I know you guys are all motivated by progressive causes and different things that drive you. But why Bernie? Rosaria, let me start with you because you're introducing him across the country. What got you so motivated to join Bernie's campaign and his fight?
Well, everything that I've done over the years has been about the people, be it from the different organizations I'm on the board of, taking across multiple platforms and issues, everything from housing to HIV/AIDS to drugs to nonpartisan voting, get out the vote. Just everything that I've been a part of is just, I understand that the intersectionality of what's going on with people and that we need to be engaged. And so if you're caring about the environment, all of these different things that you have to participate, just start someplace. And so I've as a New Yorker and someone who can multitask, I've been a part of a lot of different things. And this is a candidate who I've looked at for a long time. I've admired him for a long time. I've seen him out there doing his thing. And when he decided to run for president, and the people responded in the way that they did, not because of the mass media, not because of corporate media, not because he has a household name or a brand name, but specifically because of his message that he's had integrity with for dozens of years. I was so moved to be able to use whatever platform I had to just amplify that voice, because I'm always trying to amplify the people's voice, and I was seeing that that wasn't being heard. Mm-hmm. That there was demonstrations going across the nation, marches happening. People were going, you know, the only reason why we were still talking about him is because people were going, I have $3, mm-hmm. I'll give it to him. No super PACs, nothing. Mm-hmm. Like, just literally just watching that and being so moved by it, and not seeing it get the credence and the credit that it should. And so that's what I joined the movement, because I think what he's saying is really, really important, and what he's talking about, his stances on the environment, on LGBTQI issues, on feminism, on foreign policy, on all of these different issues that are critical for us, we need to make sure people hear that. Because when people hear him, when he has a debate, people listen and they are moved. And they switch allegiance, or they decide to vote for the first time, or they decide to vote for the first time in a long time. Mm-hmm. And that's what we need to have, is more people being able to get his message out so that they can have an actual vote and put in an actual vote in a way that they'll feel good about in the years to come.
Mm-hmm. But Rosario, he might raise your taxes.
Yeah, good on. I'm so okay with that. Please tax me more if it's gonna mean that my neighbor gets taken care of. I think, you know, we're in a time right now where we're always about, I'll pick myself up by my bootstraps, whether your bootstraps came from China. Mm. And like, let's have a reality about the fact that we're all living this planet together. And like, if you are the 10th largest company in the world, why is it that your only mission is to be the 9th largest company in the world? Why isn't it about the value for your customers and making sure that your workers are getting paid Absolutely. Fair wages so they don't have to be on welfare? Like, why aren't you looking at the quality of life that you're creating? There's only but so much you need to have, and you're not taking it with you when you're gone, you know? Mm-hmm. But the one thing you are doing is passing down a lot of values to your children, and the value shouldn't be more. It should be about what we're all getting together and our humanity, our collective humanity. And that's, I'm a humanitarian, so this is why I'm speaking out for Bernie, because he's humanitarian.
All right. Yeah. Linda, I hear that from the press that that Arabs and Jews don't often get along. So I don't know if I'm bringing this to you, but Bernie's Jewish. you sure you're okay with it? You're still on his side?
I mean, that's some of the most the ludicrous angles of the media, of being so shocked that Muslim Americans would support a Jewish candidate. And I don't support Bernie Sanders because he's a Jew. I support him because he's a man with principles and values. He's a man of integrity, a man of authenticity, unbought and unsold. He's been saying the same things for 40 years. And this is why I'm attracted to his message. I mean, look, he's a 75-year-old white man. Not exactly the kind of man you think would inspire people like us, but I'm inspired by his vision. I'm inspired by this idea that he thinks we have self-worth, that I shouldn't be settling for less, that our country should have universal health care. There are people in our country who don't have health insurance that are dying because they don't have access to medical services. Understanding that if we were able to create free public colleges, that 38% increase in young brown and black people that would be able to get a college education. I mean, I don't know what's so radical about that. And then I want to say, you know, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm also Palestinian American. Some radical guy shows up and says, hold on a second, Palestinians are human beings, by the way. They deserve dignity and human rights. Wow. You know what I mean? Like, as if that shouldn't be the default position of any presidential candidate. And he's embracing our community. Muslim Americans, Arab Americans, we have high stakes in this election. We're fighting hate. And here's an opportunity for me to vote for something, not against something. Vote for someone, not against someone. And Bernie Sanders has welcomed Arab Americans, Muslim Americans in his campaign unapologetically. He doesn't tell us to be less Muslim, less Palestinian, less of who we are. Bring it. And I'm also a person that's worked on progressive issues for about 15 years, hiring the federal minimum wage to $15. How radical is that? Impossible, but we did it in New York State, we did it in California, we did it in Seattle. Why is that something that we can't do across the country? And at the end of the day, it's about the people. And Bernie Sanders, trust me, we've hung out with him. He's about the people. He is not about Bernie Sanders. Like, sometimes you want to remind him that he's Bernie Sanders. You know what I mean? And I'm very overwhelmed in the movement and the people that I get to meet in this campaign.
Yeah, I'm amused by the idea of going up to him. You know you're Bernie Sanders. You're Bernie Sanders. All right. And I like that phrase you use, which I haven't heard before. He's unbought and unsold.
Yeah.
Right. And that's powerful. And I think that's why a lot of people have rallied around his message. Mm-hmm. One more thing about the Palestinian issue. I've never heard anyone in the public eye in America talk about Palestinian poverty. And when he said that in a debate, I couldn't believe it. I said, he's treating Palestinians so much like they're human beings, which we're unused to, unfortunately, in the American media, right, that he cares that they don't have jobs. He talked about unemployment. He talked about their poverty. So, and then it's no surprise that he won about 70% of the Muslim vote in Michigan, where he had that big upset. Was that a moment that energized Muslim Americans, Palestinian Americans, like, wow, somebody cares about us?
Absolutely. I mean, what people have to understand is that when you're running a campaign, people are simple. Voters are simple. They want to be seen. They want to be acknowledged. We exist. And for a long time, campaigns have literally passed our community by. We've been discounted, underestimated. We don't understand democracy. We come from countries where there are no democracies, so we're just going to leave these people to the side. And Bernie is going directly to the most discounted, the most marginalized communities, and saying, you matter. What do you care about? And the Palestinian issue is an issue that everyone cares about. And what's crazy is that his message of income inequality is universal. You can talk about income inequality in any country, and it's going to resonate with people. And the fact that he brought up the outrageous unemployment rates in places like Gaza and talking about illegal settlements, and the fact that he didn't show up to AIPAC, and people were like, oh, it's a scheduling issue. Really? you could have took an airplane and got there for an hour. He didn't think he needed AIPAC. And he knows those people are not going to vote for him anyway. And he's back to this idea of human rights and dignity and respect for all people on all sides. And he finally said there's two sides to this story. And when we want to be real brokers, we need to understand that there's humanity on both sides that we got. It shouldn't be radical, but you know what? It was revolutionary, and that's why I'm on this campaign.
As you can see from no one else mentioning it at AIPAC, and when he wasn't there, he still delivered a speech talking about it, which I thought was really profound.
And he's the only Jew.
Yeah, and also talking about it in one of the debates as well, talking about Henry Kissinger's policies mm-hmm. in South America, right. talking about where America stands on all of these issues and what we've done to destabilize Latin America over all these years, as we're now starting to do in the Middle East. And he's actually saying that, and the question is going, well, you said something about Castro, and then, you know, then the other candidate said the thing, well, I want to go back to what he said earlier, and I was so excited, like, great, so you're going to talk about Henry Kissinger, you're going to talk about our foreign policy over the 60s, 70s, 80s, no, what he said about Castro.
It happens on almost every debate. Explain to us why you're not a communist, why you won't be a dictator like Castro and Chavez.
Explain socialism to us again, even though we are already democratic socialist country.
Right. It was an amazing moment. In fact, on the Republican side, they had a debate about, they forcefully argued, both Cruz and Rubio, that you should not be balanced in the Middle East. You should be unbalanced.
You should carpet bomb everyone.
Yeah, that being balanced on the Palestinian-Israeli issue was unacceptable, and that the Democrats might make the mistake of treating both sides equally. God forbid, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, Nomi, you're the most unlikely to support Bernie Sanders because you're a Democratic strategist.
Because I'm actually political, because I've worked in politics, gosh. There's a few reasons why I support Bernie Sanders. One being that after the recession, we as a party should have had a moment where we reconfigured everything, where we sat there and said, listen, you know, the past 20 years of the ways that the Democratic Party has worked is not working. We're not winning the House. We're barely winning the Senate, and then we lost the Senate. We're not winning local races. We're not winning state legislatures. Something's not working here. Maybe we should fix this. And we had a recession caused by the big banks that are funding our party. What Bernie Sanders did, and he's been the same guy for 35, 40, his whole entire life, saying the same issues over and over, is he pulled back the curtain on the Democratic Party. He brought to life issues that Democrats say behind closed doors, that elected Democrats that are funded by these special interests say behind closed doors, but they know, because they want to get into office, that they have to compromise. Well, because of the way this revolution has taken place, and that was really what motivated me a lot, like what you said, seeing people just so moved by his message, is because we have the internet today. Because people are able to donate a couple bucks and create a revolution in a couple of months and take on the largest establishment Democrat in possibly the history. I mean, the Clintons are the most funded. They've raised more money than any other candidates in history combined. They have more connections to every single industry across the country, across the world. Now with the Panama Papers, we might find out more. And this man, who's been the same man with virtue, that's it, it's virtue. He's bringing virtue back to the Democratic Party, and he's spreading that message, and he's making it okay for Democrats to say things like, you know, it's okay to be pro-Palestine and pro-Israel, it's okay to meet in the middle, it's okay to talk about universal health care even though our butts were kicked. You know, one of the things that I keep saying about Bernie, people say, oh, he wants to tax everybody, he wants free education, that's not possible. You've got to negotiate from some point. You can't negotiate from the middle. And Hillary Clinton and the triangulation of the party over the past 30 years has only hurt us. There's organizations like Emily's List, which I'm so proud of Bernie Sanders for taking a stand today and profiling the injustice that's going on with Emily's List. Women have felt shamed by not supporting Emily's List. There's about a dozen organizations out there, other women's organizations, that say things like this behind closed doors, that Emily's List only profiles women of color and young women, but they don't give the money to those candidates. They're giving the money to the candidates that are well-funded, that are wealthy, that can reimburse their fund. It's a Ponzi scheme.
So there's a lot you said that I want to talk about, but let's stick with the Democratic so-called progressive groups in D.C.
Yeah.
Have they got a little bit of Stockholm syndrome, that they have been inside a Washington, D.C. bubble for so long that they now think like their captors?
I absolutely think so, and I think that there's levels of this. There are the hierarchies, the David Brocks of the world. You know, David Brock now sits on the board of CREW, Citizens for Reform and Ethics in Washington, a watchdog group that came about in the mid-2000s after the Enron scandal, after Tom DeLay, after, you know, there were multiple scandals in the mid-2000s. And David Brock, who is funneling money from a super PAC into Correct the Record, a pro-Hillary group, is now in, is one of the special interests of this organization. And you see this. You see the same people controlling these groups, and the people who work for these groups who have good hearts, or even people in the Democratic Party have good hearts, but they also know that they're either, you know, they have to pick one of the devils. And I think that they think they're realists and that they'll be shamed if they step up and speak out against the establishment that they're employed by, the Democratic establishment, which I think a lot of people, and I'm saying this purposefully, I think that people in the Democratic Party are brainwashed by the concept that this is the way you do things. We have not won this way. We have to break to the Democratic Party. The last 30 years of strategy, this new Democratic Party, DLC, BS that came about after the McGovern years in the late 70s, they reconfigured their strategy back then. Doesn't work. It's the corporatist Democrats. Yeah. And the only people it works for, who? The wealthiest.
And you're absolutely right. People with good intentions, but even groups like Common Cause now fighting against change, right? Mm-hmm. No, we're supposed to be pro-change. Right. We're the guys who need the change. We're progressives. Right now, we're not in power, right? Mm-hmm. We need desperately to get money out of politics. We need to amend the Constitution, all these things. And I want to ask about what Nomi brought up to all of you guys, the Barney Frank rule. He got interviewed by one of our reporters, Jordan Chariton, and he asked him, well, you know, you guys are taking money from the banks. And Barney Frank, of course, did the Dodd-Frank bill and was head of that committee, and he took a lot of money. And he said, I took money and I helped other Democrats take money from the banks. He said, because what do you want? You want them to get 100% of the banking money? Mm-hmm. At least we get 20%. But doesn't that set up a situation where you permanently lose 4-1? Yep. So, and if that's the case, I guess what I'm asking you guys, because obviously you get that that's a paradigm that doesn't work for progressives, is why is it so hard for the Democrats to see that? Like, why would you want to be at a permanent 4-1 disadvantage instead of upending the system entirely?
Mm-hmm. You know, I had an experience a couple years ago. I ran for Congress in 2012, and it was a disastrous campaign, partly because Emily's list turned against me and didn't support me, and partly because the Democrats recruited me, then abandoned me, which they do to a lot of people. This isn't just a situation for myself. I went to Washington to lobby a group of congressmen and senators about how do you reach millennials. And a few of us millennials in politics said, you know, the way that we structure campaigns doesn't work. No one's watching TV ads anymore. The average congressional campaign costs $2.2 million. You're raising money to buy these ads on TV because most of that money goes to TV ads, but no one's watching it. We see that with this election itself, this presidential election. And I asked a certain congresswoman, I said, you know, it would just require budging the system a little bit, just changing it a little bit. You know, you don't have to compete with Republicans all the time because their demographics are different. They're older, they're whiter, and they are watching ads. Our demographics are younger, and we could engage voters, and et cetera, et cetera. And she said, the cost of changing the system is the cost of losing a Democrat in the House. And I think that they see, they're so afraid of losing Democrats in name only in a lot of ways, that they're not willing to budge.
It's so myopic, you know, and it's ironic from the people who claim you have to be pragmatic. Right. You have to be pragmatic. But in order to win maybe one House for a conservative Democrat, one House seat, you're actually giving up your long-term strategy entirely. How could you possibly win if most of the donors are going to the Republicans and you're supporting a system that is built on private people financing elections?
I mean, in the Democratic Party, you would think that this is a time for reflection and self-reflection, and they're almost fighting even harder against it. I mean, in the month of March, Bernie Sanders raised $53 million off of an average donation of $27.
Shouldn't they celebrate that?
Right? They should be like, what are we missing
here? Right?
About 80% average of young people between ages 18 and 29 are voting for Bernie Sanders. Wouldn't you think that the young people are the future of the Democratic Party and that you would be thinking to yourself, well, wait a minute, what is Bernie doing that we're not doing? Like, can someone sit down and analyze what's going on? And I think for me, as a Democrat, and I'm not a loyal Democrat, right? Like, sometimes I don't agree with my own party that I'm a part of. I think it's really baffling to me and mind-boggling that the people who are part of the, quote, political revolution, who you need in order, we're going to be a majority-minority country, right? And they keep saying that somehow Bernie made us all white. I'm not white. I just want people to know that. National Press Secretary, black. New York State Political Director, black. New York State Director of the Bernie campaign, black. The Latino outreach people, undocumented people. People have to understand that at the core of this campaign are young people of color. We are the future of this country, and no one seems to think that that's a problem. But you know what? 20 years from now, someone's going to be like, damn, Wish we were doing more. We missed out.
So but not only that, but talking about that white. What are you even insinuating by saying that it's a white male voter? These are white male voters who are going yes to economic justice, mm-hmm. yes to racial justice, yes to environmental justice. Like this skew that's going on, and this is what's been happening for a very long time. We didn't pay attention to people marching against the war. That was a huge historical moment for mm-hmm. human beings to be coming together across the planet to say no to a war before it happened. Mm-hmm. That's never happened before. You know, we're talking about the bailout and the Occupy movement and just these pushbacks that keep happening over and over and over again, and it's dismissed. They're not talking about Democracy Spring that's happening right now. They're not talking about the people who are pushing back against the KXL pipeline until it got so loud and so vociferous and it lasted so long that they finally had to be like, okay, cool, now we finally have, as what President Obama says, when there's enough people power behind it, I can finally push back against what people want in D.C. and go, well, the people have spoken. But it needs to be that loud in order mm-hmm. for it to be taken seriously at all. And this is what's happening right now with people supporting Bernie Sanders. You got all these people going, oh, kids are don't pay attention, they're not interested, and all these different things. We have to save the party. Unity. But you're completely ignoring and dismissing, even before half of the states had even voted, going, he should just drop out. Wait, the Democratic numbers are really low right now. Like across the states, like what's surging right now are Republican voters. Mm-hmm. So how do you think that bodes well at all in the general election mm-hmm. if you're dismissing the half of the electorate, half of the states that haven't even voted yet, and then hoping that somehow party unity is gonna show up later on and you're gonna be able to defeat Trump or Cruz or whoever it is that you're after? That doesn't make any sense. What's happening right now is a complete fracture in the way that we saw after 2008, where the Koch brothers were like, okay, I got what worked here, money and people. And so money and people came together and we got the Tea Party because they were that disgusted with the Republican Party and that something needed to shift. And that is what is happening on the Democratic side. As much as they might not like it, like that is actually what is happening. Something, there's going to probably most likely the thing out of everything. If we do not get Bernie Sanders as president, at the very least, we're going to get a three-party system. That is what people are fighting for because this system is broken and this idea of you can only choose between this and this is not working for people, especially kids who are on the other side of the century. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm 36 years old, so I remember exactly that whole, the nostalgia and the reality of the last century. Mm-hmm. Now we're in a whole other century where we're going through the 90s in a season. Mm-hmm. And we're reflecting on it, but we're moving forward. These are kids who are looking into virtual reality. They're not watching the news and getting their talking points from there. Because literally every single person that I talk to who is not a Bernie Sanders person asked me the exact same five questions, which makes me think every single time of like, remember that time when Bush actually exposed how propaganda works? Because as Americans, we somehow think that because we're taught the definition of it, that we're not subject to propaganda. Mm-hmm. But he made it really clear. I'm going to say this three more times. Mm-hmm. Why? Because I'm going to put the truth into your head, and this is the culture of propaganda. That is what is happening right now. Young people are looking at that. They're looking at the videos of Bernie Sanders going, I said no to the Panama Papers, I said no to the Patriot Act, I said no to the Iraq War, and now he's saying I need to be president, and we're all going, oh my God, he is Cassandra of the Greek myths, and somehow he has been cursed to not be heated, and we are going over a cliff, and there's some people who are just telling us to just go slower. And he's telling us we need to change direction. And I do not want to be looking at his videos 20 years from now and going, we should have heeded his warning.
Mm. Could you imagine if the Greeks had put Cassandra in charge?
We'd have a very different story.
Well, so there's so much to respond to in there. First, on the Democrats, Democracy Spring. So I was there, just funny little story. I was there on Monday and I got arrested. Always hilarious. Mm-hmm. And when the cops were writing me, writing up the report on me, they got the complexion and they were like, Brown, do you mind if we say Brown?
I was like, no, I don't mind. Please arrest me, but do you mind?
I was like, no, it's okay. It is Brown and I don't mind. So for those of you who don't know, Democracy Spring is going to protest money in politics and the culture of corruption that you guys have all been talking about here and voting rights. And there are bills in Congress, some of which Bernie Sanders has backed, right? And there's an amendment where we want to get money out of politics. And, of course, Congress has done nothing about it. So they've started civil disobedience. And it was, on Monday, the largest number of people ever arrested at the Capitol in U.S. history, mm-hmm. right? And I think cable news covered it for 17 seconds, if mm-hmm. I'm not mistaken.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
isn't that amazing? And Rosario, I hear you're going on Friday.
Woo!
Hey,
very
look
excited.
At that.
Yeah.
Okay, that's
yes,
fantastic.
Absolutely. It's, you know, if there's any way, this is, I feel like that's what my duty is right now, is to try to just shed light on certain things. And yeah. for some reason, because of being an actor, people put a microphone in front of my face. But I've been an activist for way longer than I was an actor. And I always understood that injustice of someone asking me about lipstick rather than talking to me about transgender rights or, you know, talking about the housing crisis or talking about the environment and how, like, we have to say no to fracking. And how can you even think about voting for someone who's spread fracking around the world and then think that they're not going to continue to do so afterwards when you could see the flip-flopping over all the years on the issues. And we're not in a place right now where we can take, where we can evolve on the issues. You know, when, you know, I was talking about this yesterday, when the North Africa is drying up, when the Middle East is drying up, when Southern Europe is drying up right now, we're going to see more and more and more mass movement of people and issues and conflict due to climate change. And we need someone who's going to be aggressive on that right now and not be on the wrong side of history and not going to evolve to the issue. We need someone who's going to make some moves right now, does not have to hesitate on the KXL pipeline, does not have to hesitate on fracking, and start moving and pushing us towards renewable energies. And so for me, like being able to go down there and talking about money and politics and showing up at Democracy Spring, if it encourages just the folks that are there and it doesn't get the attention that it needs to in the mass media, that's okay, because I'm a big fan of preaching to the crowd. Mm-hmm. So, you know, sometimes you need to be encouraged. Yeah. And the people who are out there who are taking the courage to encourage others to show up and do something about what they're complaining about is a really, really beautiful thing. So I'm happy to do that. But it also, if it brings and sheds some light onto it so that we can actually start, you know, doing the news and talking about, wow, because if that's not news, especially with it being the largest demonstration, the most arrests ever at the Capitol, if that's not news, then I don't know what is. So yeah. hopefully we can shed some light to that, because it's important what's happening outside of those walls.
I want to say two things about that. So when I was part of the protests on Monday, so there was thousands of protesters, and then 432 were willing to risk arrest and then ultimately did get arrested. It took them the whole day to arrest all of us. They ran out of buses. Mm-hmm. They ran out of space. And so we started at noon, and I got out of the holding cell at 11 o'clock at night, right? Mm-hmm. But as we were marching, I didn't quite get a sense of how many people were there. And then when we got to the Capitol steps, we turned around, and I saw this wave of people, mm-hmm. and it felt amazing, yeah. right? And the more people there are there, the more power that you feel, and you're supposed to. Yeah. In a democracy, we're supposed to have the power.
Yeah. Exactly.
The people are supposed to have the power. And the donors have had the power for so long that we all have Stockholm Syndrome, like as if that's normal, yeah. right? Mm-hmm. Princeton did that study over two decades, 1,800 policy positions, and public opinion has no correlation to policy. That means you don't live in a democracy, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah,
and so, and by the way, the one group that had a direct correlation to policy was special interests and donors.
Right. Yep.
They have captured the government. It's obvious when you do private financing of election, the politicians work for the people who finance them.
Right.
If you did public financing, they might work for the public,
absolutely.
Right? It's not that complicated. And so 432 people got arrested, and I was talking to someone else from the press today, and I said, imagine if 432 Tea Party patriots
right.
had gotten arrested, and it was the largest arrest ever at the
yep.
Capitol. It would be 24/7 news.
Yep,
isn't it amazing? I think we all have to just get used to the fact that the corporate media is the establishment.
Mm-hmm. So can I ask a question just as a pushback? I do a lot of media every day. And part of me feels like they wanted to make the Tea Party look like the bad guys. Mm-hmm. And so I'm questioning, do they not want the liberals to look bad?
No.
Or do they just not want to give them attention for what
no,
they're saying?
I think that in their core, they are dismissive. Like, liberals right. can't ever win. Mm-hmm. They're not a relevant part of the conversation. Mm-hmm. Now, they don't know that they're doing that. Like, if you asked, and I can name names, right?
Mm-hmm.
If
yeah.
you asked the Anderson Coopers and the Chris Matthews of the world, I think that they would think that they were good guys and they're trying to look out for everybody and yada mm-hmm. yada. And they never got in a room together and shook on it, right? They weren't like, okay, let's screw over the liberals. Agreed, yeah, let's do that, right? I think that they don't realize that they got put in that position because they wouldn't rock the boat.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't radicals.
Yep.
They weren't going to be too progressive on air. They were just going to go right down the middle. Good job, you get to keep your job and your multi-million dollar contract. And they know a lot of other people in that same bucket, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so when they see progressives, they think, poor guys,
mm-hmm.
they'll never win, right? Mm-hmm. But guys, isn't it true that we always win? Like,
yeah.
not in the short run, but in the long run.
Yeah.
I mean, women's rights, women couldn't vote. Right. How in the world were you going to get the right to vote? That was impossible, right? And after having done the impossible in civil rights, women's rights, gay rights, they still doubt and they still look at it and go, never. So, you know, being women activists, one, does that energize you to fight harder? And two, and how do we do it?
I mean, if you look at the, it's not just a dismissal of the progressive and the we never win, it's also an immediate dismissal of the issues that we're working on. Voter rights, people assume voter rights is something that happens in Mississippi and Alabama. In the state of New York, we have some of the most draconian voter suppression laws in the country. We have a closed primary. If you want to change your party, you have to do it 6 months in advance in the primary, which in New York would have been before the first debate where Bernie Sanders actually came out and introduced himself to the whole country. So even if you wanted to vote in the New York State primary, a lot of millennials who are unaffiliated or registered with a very viable third party in the state of New York, which is the Working Families Party, couldn't change their party. So they're literally left out of the system right now. And there was an article about it in The Guardian recently. So it's a dismissal of the issue. They don't want voter rights. Voter rights in particular and money out of politics and election reform, it benefits a particular segment of the establishment, and they don't want it to seem like it's some sort of nationwide issue that everybody should be working on. For me, the bottom line is I care about women's reproductive rights, immigrant rights, all these things, but at the end of the day, it's election reform, it's voter rights, because if we don't have the power to participate in the democracy, then we are not gonna be able to change things in the short term or the long term. And voter rights, what, yes, it passed in the civil rights movement in 1964, guess what? We're farther back behind, we're literally taking ourselves back 20 years, and people are just walking around like it's a normal thing to do. So I think that it's not just a dismissal of the progressives never win, it's a dismissal of the actual issues that we're trying to get people to focus on. And Bernie Sanders is the guy that's like, I'm winning states by 12%, but I'm getting the same amount of delegates. And everyone's like, the system is rigged. And then they blame the young people. Oh, you're apathetic, this is all your fault. I don't blame young people for being like, the system is rigged and I don't want to participate in it. Create election reform and opportunities for young people to participate and show them that their vote really matters. Because right now, on the national level and federal presidential elections in the primaries, believe it or not, your vote doesn't matter.
No, but when Princeton does that study and says over 20 years, your vote hasn't mattered at all. So I know that that's depressing and I want people to vote. I desperately want them to vote. But young people are more correct than we are, right? Except for Bernie Sanders. And look at that. Again, young people are correct. They go, this one does count, right? Yeah. In this case, if we actually got money out of politics, then the rest of our votes would matter.
Yep.
So we're going to show up for this one, and they do, and he wins those states that they didn't expect him to win. In the case of Michigan, he wins it by much larger
numbers. He wins open primaries where people are allowed to shift party. So if you're independent, he wins in states where there's same-day voter registration, which we don't have in states like New York. Like, he wins in the places where there is better election reform.
And that's designed. I spoke to an election attorney who used to work for the DNC the other day, and she told me, she said, every state, their state election laws are designed by the legislatures, but the legislatures actually have written it out, in most legislatures, that it is heavily influenced by the parties. So you look at Iowa. I was in Iowa, and for the caucuses, and I found it shocking that the caucus locations were so small on these college campuses, where there was lines out the door for the caucuses, the doors were supposed to shut at 7 o'clock, and there were 400 people out the door that couldn't participate in the caucus. And so I asked the person who was chairing the caucus, I said, who chose this location? Oh, well, the local party did. And then one woman walked up to me and said, 4 years ago we had a much larger location, but they knew there was going to be turnout. Well, who was the local party chair? The local party chair endorsed Hillary Clinton. So the mechanics of this, very well, Hillary Clinton lost in 08 to Barack Obama, and that set the tone for the campaign, right? Iowa is so important. So I have no doubt that Hillary and her many surrogates out there that are elected officials and party leaders went there and tried to legally, because it is legal, unfortunately, influence the mechanics of the primary system. And that's something I think that's really great about this campaign is people are finally waking up to that behind the scenes stuff.
By the way, same thing happened in Wisconsin.
Exactly.
In all the universities where the students were voting, 4-hour lines. Mm-hmm. And in Arizona, when they asked one of the people in charge of the voting areas, look, there's a 3-4-hour line. Whose fault is this? She said, it's the voters' fault for showing
up. Right.
For showing up. The audacity and the things that have been said on this are really remarkable. Like when they explain, like, we're so sorry, yes, in October you would have had to change your affiliation from an independent or whatever in order to vote for Trump or to vote for Bernie Sanders. But, that's specifically built to protect the party because in McGovern was such an upset.
Exactly.
And so we're making sure that the established voters
who are well aware of what the rules are will make sure that so we don't have an insurgent, because of course Bernie Sanders is an insurgent, he's a terrorist or something, so that we don't have a disruption of the system. And coming from doing voter registration for 12 years, you know, I can tell you, you know, I sit down with millionaires and billionaires to be the people who are funding candidates, and they come and they're like, how can we, you know, what is, you know, watching how the whole system works, they're not interested in giving money to organizations to do voter registration. Mm-hmm. They don't want new voters because you don't know what new voters are gonna do. Like, so what they want, though, is GOTV. They want to give you money for after the fact so you can start to manipulate, okay, where do you think your demographic is going to vote, and how can we give money to help in those situations so that we can work with the people we already have and not actually expand it to have new voices, because those voices are too risky.
So the way you guys lay it out is fascinating, because, and I'm not sure I ever quite vocalized it in the way that you guys have. So right now Bernie Sanders is energizing a younger generation, and if you're a party, you should love that younger generation being on your side. Mm-hmm. He's getting people to...
You're talking about 45 and younger,
right,
too.
Right. Which
is, and that number keeps inching up more. The more time he gets on air, the higher those numbers go. And I have plenty of people in their 70s who are like, stop saying that I'm only 20-year-old. I've waited for a candidate my whole life to vote like this. But
that's
yes,
right.
45 and younger.
People who are energized and motivated to get money out of politics, which would finally, you know, help the Democrats be on an even playing field. Mm-hmm. God, they should be so excited about that, yeah, right? And then number three, what you mentioned, the white male voters. If you got white male voters raising their hand going, yes, I love the most progressive person in the campaign, isn't this what the Democrats dreamed of? And now that he's come here, it seems like the Democratic establishment is spinning in his eye in a lot of ways. And to your point, Nomi, it's not a coincidence. I mean, we know Debbie Wasserman Schultz used to work for Hillary Clinton.
Right.
I mean, this I haven't seen a DNC this clearly on one side in my lifetime.
I was part of this. I was part of the DNC, but they have this operation for those under 45 where you don't have full rights. It's ridiculous. And I left a couple years ago because we were it was a fake organization. We'd go to these meetings, these events where they'd bring, you know, Tim Kaine or some, you know, some famous lawmaker, and you get to talk to them, and then we'd say, okay, well, you know, can we have a say in the process? Can we be part of the superdelegate system? No. So the way that the DNC is structured, from the rulemaking, and we see this through Tulsi Gabbard, who stepped down, because many of these vice chairs say it's not even a real position. We have no authority. The process making is very internal. It is very much guided by Debbie Wasserman Schultz and maybe a few other people. I have no doubt that Hillary Clinton was involved in the process, so much so that when they created the policy, they ended the policy that blocked lobbyists from giving money to the DNC. That was an Obama-Biden policy. And Obama and Biden decided that they weren't going to, despite the fact that they changed that policy just a few months ago and brought lobbyists back in, Obama and Biden said, no, we are not accepting lobbyist money. So,
which is just legal.
I mean, they're not running for anything, but it shows the schism.
Is there any reasonable belief that Hillary Clinton, after winning her, if she were to win this, after winning every election she's been in because she got more money, because she used lobbyists, she used donors, et cetera, would then turn around and say, no, I'm going to get rid of money in politics?
Who knows? I have no idea. That's the whole thing. That's what makes it so clear to me that who I'm going to vote for, because I know that the person who I'm voting for has integrity and has authenticity, and I know when he gets into the office that he's not going to suddenly turn around and become someone different. He's literally going to go in there and he's going to leave the door open and go, okay, let's get to work. He's not going to shut the door, pretty much like any other candidate who's running right now, who's just going to go, thank you so much for getting me here, I'll take it from here. No, he's actually, the whole point of what he's doing, and it's learning from the 2008 election, where there was a huge swell of voter registration and people mobilizing and showing up, and then they were stopped being communicated with. The part, you know, the group that was created to get them going was dismantled and put under the umbrella of the DNC, and they did not continue that momentum to have people showing up in the midterm elections and then the next election, which ended up having the record low, 72-year record low of voter turnout. That's how do you go from one of the most mass demonstrations of people to suddenly a huge record low in voter turnout, which ended up giving us Citizens United, which ended up giving us voter ID laws coming sweeping across the nation, and all of these different things that came from it that empowered the other side. So like he's learned from that moment and recognizes that his momentum, what people are like, how is he going to get it through? How is he going to get all of his ideas through? First off, the only thing the president can absolutely do when they walk in is press that shiny red button and take us to war. And Bernie Sanders besides Jill Stein, is the only person that I truly believe is not going to take us immediately to war, just based on people's records, mm-hmm. okay? And like maybe Trump as well, but he's already kind of picked a fight with mm-hmm. Mexico. They're already cursing at us. But like in general, also him as well, he's not going out there going, let's expand war as an effort. But when you look at everyone's APEC speeches, you can tell that that's not the case with everybody else. And when you're talking about no-fly zones in Syria or all these yep. other things, you're going, no, you're picking fights with Putin. You're picking fights. You're setting us up for war. So that's the one thing for me immediately, just on that alone, Bernie has my vote. But when you look at the reality of him going, but let's shoot for, yeah. let's aim high. Like, you don't start the game going, I'm going to bunt it.
Yeah.
I'm going to let the ball hit me a couple times and walk to first. Like, no, you're aiming to get that, to shoot it out of the park. And if it lands someplace else, then you strategize around that. You just had Gene Sanders on here talking about that. You aim high, and then when it, however it goes, he strategizes. He's one of the most progressive on being able to reach across the aisle with independents, with Republicans and Democrats, all of whom want to actually vote for him in the general election, which I've never seen so many Republicans and independents and people going, I'm excited to switch my allegiance or do whatever so I can vote for someone that I really truly believe in, that I think is authentic and real and honest, and I want to be behind that. This is the situation that we're finding ourselves in and going, are we going to shoot ourselves in the foot? Are we going to just have a bunch of people not show up because they're so disgusted with the process? Or are we going to continue to invigorate this base that is growing because they want to? Not because they're being even asked to, but because themselves are going, I want to be a part of this process. And then actually really see what that does to transform mm-hmm. our politics. Because that's what's going to be the momentum that we're going to need going into the... Because there's like 40 seats in this election alone right now that we're not even talking about.
No,
what about the midterm elections? Mm-hmm. Like, you're going, it's impossible. Yeah, it's impossible for the government that we have right now and the money in politics that we have right now. So if you want that to continue perpetuating, don't vote for Bernie Sanders. But if you want the government that you really, truly believe we deserve, that we need to step into the 21st century, Bernie Sanders is your guy, and he's gonna have the people yep. behind him to take it to the next level and change the establishment from the inside out.
I mean, if we wanna win in November, I'm an organizer, and when I tell somebody we gotta go stand in front of the court because we need to indict a police officer who killed an unarmed black kid, I don't tell people, look, we're gonna go in front of the court, but you know nothing's gonna happen, right? You know it doesn't matter, right? Like, we're not gonna win, right? This is not realistic. This is not how you inspire people. Most voters are not people that understand the details of the issues. No one picks up the platform of a candidate. Most voters don't. No one reads between the lines, right? People are moved by people and their personalities and what they say. And when someone tells you, the power is in your hands. You matter. Your votes matter. This is what moves people to the polls. And if we want to win in November, if the Democrats want to win in November, they better start getting some charisma up in that campaign because it's not there. And I'm not moved by it. And I don't do things that I'm not moved by. You got to convince me a reason why I should go to the polls. And these young people, Bernie's convincing them. And he's telling them that you matter. The power is in your hands. And if the other party's telling me, actually, you don't really have that much power. Actually, what you really want is not going to happen. I don't know how they expect people to turn out in the droves, and I don't think that's going to happen unless there's a huge paradigm shift in the conversation that we're having.
Yeah, and you know, Bernie also has the most detailed plans. If you actually go, he explains exactly yeah. how he's going to do it. But it's Hillary Clinton feels like we have to prove to her that we will be loyal to her if she right. wins. But the onus is actually the other way around.
Exactly.
You have to earn our vote, and so the onus is on you to reach out to younger people, to all the categories that you guys mentioned, to say, no, I am actually going to represent you guys. Mm-hmm. And to your point, Rosario, if you want a home run for progressive issues, mm-hmm. you aim for a home run. But that's only if you want a home run for
right,
progressive
exactly.
issues.
The will. Yeah.
If you only want a little bit of change and some in this direction and some in the other direction, you don't swing for the fences.
I have a theory about this. I think, well, there's two things. There's a clear divide between Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders in their support. And I really, truly feel this way. The people who are still hurting after the economy are the people supporting Bernie Sanders. And Bernie Sanders is speaking to them, their needs, their pains, their wants, their hopes, their futures. And I think much of the support, not all of it, that Hillary Clinton has are people who've done okay with the economic turnaround. Those who aren't struggling to pay their rent, those who aren't struggling with the cost of living, those who don't need to apply an oxygen mask to their mouths to survive. And Bernie Sanders represents that oxygen mask for the Democratic Party, in the future of the Democratic Party, and for the ability of affecting change. The other point I want to make is, I see the connection between Wall Street and Hillary Clinton as risk. You know, anybody who knows anything about economics and Wall Street understands that they don't want to take risks, ironically, right? you know, they don't, anybody who's an investor doesn't want to take big risks. So they're supporting Hillary Clinton because they know she's going to be incremental, that she may very well not get anything passed, sweeping measures, economic measures. And they're scared of that. And anybody in that system, in that bubble who buys into that, you know, that's a big group of people. And in New York, that's a very large group of people. And they're saying that out loud. And they're afraid. They're afraid of going back to an era where corporations didn't rule. They're afraid of a pre-trickle-down economics era. They're afraid of another FDR who's going to create a new deal and up their taxes. And they've got multiple networks from all the way from Fox News and Fox Business to CNBC to CNN. I'm going to get in so much trouble right now. NBC. They're all controlled. We don't see those diagrams of the corporations that control them. There are a lot of people employed by those corporations at the higher levels who are buying into the DNC, buying into to Hillary Clinton, who say, okay, you can be progressive on a few social issues because people don't care for the most part. The country's moved. But it's those economic issues. And that's what scares me.
And I'll ask one more theory. The theory is that the other side is so ugly, so hateful, so dangerous that somehow default votes are going to go into Hillary's campaign in the general election. And I think this idea that there's default votes, I think, is problematic. That, yes, the other side is ugly and dangerous and hateful, but people still need to be courted. People still need to be brought into the campaign. So I think that's another theory of they're just ignoring.
Well, Chris Hedges was talking about that being the history of propaganda, and like after Freud and all of that kind of stuff, we were realizing that it wasn't facts or reason that moved people, but actually emotion. Mm-hmm. And that's when you saw like the DOJ making films and cartoons even being used to manipulate people and all that kind of stuff, and that continues on to today. So when you see, and you're talking about, so CNN is not going to talk about the fact that there was a mass sit-in outside of their offices in LA, but they're also going to go back. I did a, you know, as a surrogate, something that I said about the email server investigation by the FBI got made a big issue and made everybody really upset. So they asked, you know, Jake Tepper asked Bernie about it on the air. And I said something about, oh, CNN's really not happy that I talked about the sit-in. And he replied back to me directly, being like, oh, you know, I didn't even know about the sit-in. I went, well, there you go. You just proved my point. Like, you should know about it because you're asking about a comment that I made in a speech where I also mentioned the CNN sit-in. So I'm not, that's why I didn't say you, Jake, was the problem. I said CNN is the person, is the larger group that has an agenda. Because you are given the same way that my cousin who used to work at Fox News, and she would get in thousands and thousands of hours of footage from the Iraq War in Afghanistan, and they would edit it down to a 30-second clip, and then that was what was put on the air with the spin on it. And then that's what she would watch her family and her friends argue about. And she said, I can't even talk about politics or any of this stuff anymore with you because you were literally arguing over the piece of information you were given to argue about. You do not, I am telling you, literally have the whole picture. And even if someone who watches in Spanish and English, I watched some, you know, on English news, this soldier running in and saving this baby from this fallen, decrepit building. In the Spanish news, it showed that same soldier blow up that space and then go in and save now that child, that little orphan. So like in so many different ways and spins, like we're not getting the full picture. And there, when it's that consistent across the board, there's definitely agenda that's there. And maybe it's just because, you know what, it's too broad and we have a broad audience and we have to make it entertaining and we can only give people, because they have short attention span, we can only give them 30 to, but you're a proof positive that that is not true by the millions of people that watch the Young Turks and watch these long form interviews so that they can get information because they want to have that. And that's what this next generation is bringing to the conversation of going, I don't want a soundbite. I want full information. I want to be able to like really look at it and then judge it. And my friend, so when I post it and then my friend goes, what? You clearly didn't see that interview or this. And they go back and forth and they're educating themselves. We're in the time of Wikipedia where people just go on my own time just because I am going to volunteer my time to put in information for other people to have. Just because. That is where our society is moving. That's why we're not afraid of an idea of a social democrat, because he's not talking about new programs. He's talking about expanding the ones we already have. We already do public education that's free up until high school. Just expand it to college. Make that expectation for our young people that we expect them to go to school, like that we're going to put in infrastructure across the nation and take that from going out to war and destroying other people's native homes. Look at Libya. Look at the ruins that have been done there. Like, that is generations that is going to be impacted. Like, that's horrible. It is not okay in any way, shape, or form. And our infrastructure is crumbling. Mm-hmm. Why are we doing that? Why is that our focus?
Mm-hmm. Can I make one point?
Same thing.
I spent some time in Libya, and I'm really frustrated that there's another thing that Democrats are doing is they don't want to touch Hillary's record in the State Department. and it's not good. It's just not good at all. The best thing she did was open Myanmar, and that's questionable. You guys, how do we talk about that? How do we talk about, did Barack Obama open it up by saying his biggest failure was Libya and not preparing for the future a couple days ago when he said that? Is this an opening for us to have a real conversation about how she was too focused on running for president and trying to do 15 things at once that she couldn't even make a plan for the day after the Tomahawks hit the weapons facilities in Libya to collect weapons from the people of Libya, to collect from the militias?
Yeah, in that case, I don't think that it was that she was too busy. She just believes in that concept. She believes in what she called a muscular foreign policy. Mm-hmm. And she wanted to emphasize to the press after the March 15th elections, when she thought it was already all over, she emphasized them, don't worry, I will be more muscular than Obama in foreign policy. Isn't it interesting? I mean, look at the assumptions built into that. Mm-hmm. Bombing is always correct.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's not. It wasn't a mistake. That was the intention, right? Mm-hmm. And the press has to be told not to worry. Don't worry, we'll give you more wars, mm-hmm. right?
Arms trades to Saudi Arabia, which right. is being used against people in Yemen. Like this just expansion of just abuse that is going on around the world as a priority. And you know, that's for me where I sit back and I go, how can you vote for someone who said yes to the Iraq war who said it was like a good business opportunity?
Yeah.
Like it's startling to me. I'm like, that reminds me of another Secretary of State that said 500,000 dead Iraqi children was worth it.
Right.
Like, and I don't understand how you can say you're good with children and good in women's rights when you haven't clearly interviewed any Honduran children mm-hmm. or Syrian children or Libyan children or Iraqi children. Yeah. Like, why don't they count? Mm-hmm. And I really don't understand that. You know, so okay, maybe she won't roll back women's rights against in America, which you know, she's also said that there's caveats to that. You know, but like, but then what is this line that is drawn? Like, Trump is a horrible person because he wants to put a wall between us and Mexico, but that's okay for you when Netanyahu says that he wants to do that between Israelis and Palestinians, like that, like, you know, so it's just, it's really fascinating, like, where that rhetoric is okay and where it's not for people who consider themselves really progressive and are really looking at these issues. But like, I see a lot of racism and sexism and nationalism and ageism and all of these different things that stop people from having that thought extend to yep. other human beings.
Yep.
And so it's like, if it's only here in America and it satisfies a certain idea that I have about people being okay here, fine, I'm good, I can vote for that. But I somehow, what, Iraq?
Who cares about those people?
Yeah. Really? Because that's the thing, then, when you get really upset and we're praying for Paris and we're praying for Brussels and we're praying for people all around the world where these attacks are going on, believe me, that's not going to stop.
Yep.
Yeah.
When you're destroying people's homes and livelihoods and impacting them for generations, that is the way to fight back against that is not the cartoon, my gun's gonna get bigger and bigger. The only two things that are gonna happen, we're either going to just drop an A-bomb on everybody and that's it and we're done, or at some point we're gonna finally switch directions and go, that is not the way to keep moving forward.
Absolutely.
We have to start working together and recognizing the humanity on everybody, on this side yep. of the button and on that side of the bomb.
Mm-hmm. All right, that's a great place to end. And I think that you guys have done an amazing job of pointing out the two sides, and the one side that is for change and others that don't benefit from change.
Mm-hmm.
And so would like to protect the system that we have because it is to their benefit.
Absolutely.
And so great pleasure talking to you, Rosario, Linda, Nomi. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank
we really, really appreciate
thank
it. Thanks for joining us on the Young Turks.